I sing to you. I sing to you, Genevieve. I sing to you. You don't exist. I sing to you, though. Address you, who am I talking to? Standing in the front yard like an open wound, repeating I love you to who? I picture you when we first met. You were 22. I drove my truck onto the ferry to Victoria in the morning, where we met and talked forever in your apartment with evening falling. So I brought my blankets in and slept on the floor right next to your bed in the morning. I saw you standing right above me, peeling an orange and looking hungry. Do you want some? You asked me and then just avalanched into me with pieces of orange and weight and kissing and a certainty. I remember you a few days later in Tofino, where we'd driven to play a show you'd set up for us at a surf shop. No one. Then we slept in the back of my truck and got woken up by the cops, and so went down to the fishing boat docks to ask whoever for a ride across the water to Mears Island to just get left there for the day. And we did, and brought some food to eat, and went through the big trees abandoned and in love, totally insane apart from the rest of the world. Finally found each other in the universe, lying on the rocks waiting for the boat to come pick us up. I read the one book we had with us aloud, with my head on your lap, sinking into you, Tintin in Tibet in French. And we thought of devotion and snow and distant longing and the Himalayan air, high and cold, the bell ringing out. And then right before you died 13 years later in our house, I remember through your gasping for oxygen, you explained that you were thinking about that high cold air wrapping the above the mountains of the gods. And I do picture you there, molecules dancing. But I'd rather you were in the house watching the unfolding everyday life of this good daughter we made, instead of being scattered by the wind for no reason. So I sing to you.
Thank you.
you are gone and that I'm carrying some version of you around. Some untrustworthy old description in my memories. And that must be your ghost taking form, created every moment by me dreaming you so. Is it my job now to hold whatever's left of you for all time, and to reenact you for our daughter's life? I do remember. That life ends and it's just over. That a point comes where we no longer get to say or do anything. And then what? I guess just forgotten. And I said to my mom that I hope to do something important with my life. Not be famous, but just remembered a little more. To echo beyond my actual end. And my mom laughed at this kid trying to wriggle his way out of mortality, of the final inescapable feral scream. But I held that hope and grew up wondering what dying means. Unsatisfied, ambitious, and squirming. The first dead body I ever saw in real life was my great-grandfather's embalmed in a casket in Everett, in a room by the freeway where they talked me into reading a thing from the Bible about walking through a valley in the shadow of death. But I didn't understand the words. I thought of actually walking through a valley in a shadow with a backpack and a tent. But that dead body next to me spoke clear and metaphor-free. In December 2001, after having spent the summer and fall traveling mostly alone around the country that was spiraling into war and mania, little flags were everywhere. I was living on the periphery as a 23-year-old, wrapped up in doing what I wanted. And it was music and painting on newsprint, and eating all the fruit from the tree like Tarzan or Walt Whitman. Voracious, devouring life, singing my songs. Sleeping in yards without asking permission. That December I was shaken by a pregnancy scare from someone that I'd been with for only one night, many states away, who I hadn't planned to keep knowing. A young and embarrassing, overconfident animal night. Terror of the idea of fatherhood at 23 destroyed my foundation and left me freaked out and wandering around, mourning the independence and solitude that defined me then. Though my life is a galaxy of subtleties, my complex intentions and aspirations do not matter at all in the face of the crushing flow of full time. I saw my ancestors as sad and misunderstood in the same way that my descendants will swim back through a fog trying to see some polluted version of all I mean to be in life. Their recollections pruned by the accidents of time, what got thrown away and what gets talked about at night. But she had her period eventually, and I went back to being 11 years later, I was traveling alone again on an airplane from New Zealand to Perth, Western Australia. Very alone, so far away from you and the home that we had made. I watched a movie on the plane about Jack Kerouac, a documentary going deeper than the usual congratulations. They interviewed his daughter, Jan Kerouac, and she tore through the history. She told about this deadbeat drinking, watching Three Stooges on TV, not acknowledging his paternity, abandoning the child, taking cowardly refuge in his self-mythology. I heard your voice telling me about the adults who had abandoned you as a sweet kid and left you to grow precariously. And when she spoke, I looked in her face and saw you looking back at me. On a tiny airplane seat screen at the bottom of the world, I saw a French-Canadian resemblance and heard suffering echoing. A lineage of bad parents and strong daughters withstanding. And she had black hair and freckles and pale skin just like you. And she told the hard truth and slayed the gods just like you. I saw the cracks in the facade of posterity. I missed you, so I went home. The second dead body I ever saw was huge in the air. When I watched you turn from alive to dead right here in our house. And I looked around the room and asked, are you here? And you weren't, and you are not here. I sing to you though. I keep you breathing through my lungs in a constant, uncomfortable stream of memories trailing out until I am dead too. And then eventually the people who remember me will also die, containing what it was like to stand in the same air with me and breathe and wonder why. And then distortion, the silence of space, the night palace, the ocean blurring, but in my tears right now, light gleams. cafes, all reading books like being mortal, all with the look in their eyes. And I remember still feeling like no one can understand. No, my devastation is unique. But people get cancer and die. People get hit by trucks and die. People just living their lives get erased for no reason, with the rest of us watching from the side. And some people have to survive and find a way to feel lucky to still be alive, to sleep through the night. Fell apart, how the person I loved got killed by a bad disease out of nowhere for no reason, and me living in the blast zone with our daughter and etc. I made these songs, and then the next thing I knew I was standing in the dirt under the desert sky at night outside Phoenix at a music festival that had paid to fly me in to play these death songs to a bunch of young people on drugs, standing in the dust next to an idling bus with Skrillex inside and the sound of subwoofers in the distance. I had stayed up till three talking to Wiseblood and Father John Misty about songwriting in the backstage bungalows, eating fruit and jumping on the bed like lost children, exploding across the earth in a self-indulgent, all-consuming wreck of ideas that blot out the stars. To be still alive felt so absurd. People get cancer and die. People get hit by trucks and die. People just living their lives get erased for no reason, with the rest of us averting our eyes. Skrillex's tour bus waiting for the hotel shuttle in the middle of the night. I barely knew who I was. I looked up and saw Orion wielding a club and a shield. And there you were again, majestic. Dead wife. As my grief becomes calcified, frozen in stories and in these songs I keep singing, numbing it down, the unsingable real memories of you and the feral eruptions of sobbing. These waves hit less frequently. Thin, and then they are gone. You are gone, and then your echo is gone, and then the crying is gone, and what is left of this merchandise? This is what my life feels like now. Like I got abruptly dropped off on the side of the road in the middle of a long, horrible ride in a hot van. It was too full of confident, chattering dudes. And the sound of tires receding. say now only. I don't wanna live with this feeling any longer than I have to, but also I don't want you to be gone. So I talk about you all the time, including the last day that you were alive. And I hang your pictures around the house for me to surprise myself with and cry. Everybody that used to know us seems concerned, but if they knew that when you enter my mind, I'm full of the love that illuminated our house for all those years and made this dancing child who tears through the days with a brilliant sang along with, but you're sleeping out in the yard now. What am I saying? No one is sleeping. You don't even have a dead body anymore. It was taken away. I went and wrote a check and got a cardboard box full of your ashes and a little plastic bag with your necklace, and I drove back home truly alone. I guess I didn't bury it deep enough when I poured out your ashes beneath the three witch hazels that you planted in the yard a few years ago in a triangle for us, where me and the kid were rolling in the grass the other day and I saw actual chunks of your bones bleached and weathered, unerasable. You're still out there in the spring upheaving, coming out of the ground into air. Is that exact fragment your finger that once caressed me not that long ago? I still can feel it. And is that other shard a piece of your skull that once contained the wild brain that used to overflow with loving, undiscovered and gone, and now just shrapnel? sit and picture myself curled up beneath 10 feet of water at the bottom of the lake. I imagine trout bumping against me in the low diminished light, holding my breath, trying to be a boulder, eroding to join you in remingling with the background of churned muck coalescing in the dark. I know no one now. Now I say you. Now after the ground has opened up, now after you died, I wonder what could beacon me forward into the rest of life. I can glimpse occasional moments gleaming like bonfires burning from across the fjord. Nikolai Astrup that shines on my computer screen in 2017, in the awful July night. The house is finally quiet and still, with a child asleep upstairs. So I sit and notice the painting of bonfires on the hillside and hanging smoke in the valley. Wrapping back up through the fjords at dusk, hovering like scarves of mist draped along the ridges above couples dancing in the green twilight around fires and in the water below. The reflections of other fires from other parties illuminate the depths and glitter. Everyone is laughing and there's music, and a man climbs up the hill pulling a juniper bough to throw into the fire to make some sparks rise up to join the stars. These people in the painting believed in magic and earth, and they all knew loss, and they all came to the fire. I saw this one young woman in the foreground with a look of desolation and a body that looked pregnant as she leaned against the moss-covered rocks off to the side. Apart from all the people celebrating midsummer, I knew her person was gone, just like me. And just like me, she looked across at the fires from far away and wanted something in their light to say, live your life. And if you don't, the ground is definitely ready at any moment to open up again. swallow you back in, to digest you back into something useful for somebody. And meanwhile, above all these Norwegians dancing in the twilight, the permanent white snow gleams. Black eyes gazing, drawing the fire into herself, standing alone. Nikolai Astrup, he also died young at 47, right after finishing building his studio at home, where he probably intended to keep on painting his resonant life into old age. But sometimes people get killed before they get to finish all the things they were going to do. That's why I'm not waiting around anymore. That's why I tell you that I love you. Does it even matter what we leave behind? I'm flying on an airplane over the Grand Canyon, imagining strangers going through the wreckage of this flight if it were to crash. And would anyone notice or care, gathering up my stuff from the desert below? Would they investigate the last song I was listening to? But they go through my phone and see the last picture I ever took was of our sleeping daughter early this morning, getting ready to go. And I was struck by her face, sweet in the blue light of our dim room. Would they follow the thread back and find her there? I snap back out of this plane crash fantasy, still alive. And I know that's not how it would go. I know the actual mess that death leaves behind just gets bulldozed in a panic by the living, pushed over the waterfall, because that's me now, holding all your things, resisting the inevitable flooding of the archives, the scraps distributed by wind, a life's work just left out in the rain. But I'm doing what I can to reassemble a poor substitute version of you made of the fragments and drawings that you left behind. I go through your diaries and notebooks at night. Still cradling you in me. There's another Nikolai Astrup painting from 1920 called Foxgloves that hangs on the fridge. Grazing with their red dresses against the white birch tree trunks, interweaving beneath the clattering leaves. The three stumps in the foreground remind me that everything is fleeting, as if reminding's what I need. But then the foxgloves grow, and I read they're the first flowers that return to disturbed ground, logging took place, or where someone like me rolled around wailing in a clearing. Now I don't wonder anymore if it's significant that all these foxgloves spring up on the place where I'm about to build our house and go to live and let you fade in the night air, surviving with what dust is left of you here. Now you will recede into the painting.
Skeletally intertwined once, but now I
notice ravens instead. I don't see you anywhere.